that's one of the problems of the past, that when I went to school, I was entirely siloed away and I had no clue. Maybe there were some advantages about it that I'm not aware of. Maybe more focus, more time, you know, a little bit also protected. But my mind was blown when I moved to Berlin and realized what type of jobs exist. And not only what was in the books or what you kind of get taught by your parents. And I think if that would happen much earlier, just a real life awareness instead of, you know, maybe I'm preaching to the choir, of course, I guess, but it would have brought me forward years, you know, like that. I was like poking around, how much did I study? And just like 3-4 years later, I had talked to enough people that told me about their lives that I could know what my career would be.
Hello there, wonderful humans. Don't you think there's a great overlap between the decentralized campuses and micro schools that we're starting to see and co-working spaces? There's always been a lot of overlap in my mind of how these places could be connected together into a learning ecosystem. In fact, some universities have gone and rented whole WeWork buildings just so their students who were stranded during COVID could find a place to work. This is the first kind of glimpse into higher education using a decentralized campus, and I think is a marker of things to come. In this video, I'm speaking to Christoph Fahle, who is the founder of Beta House and One Coworking. One Coworking is one of the largest networks of co-working spaces across all of Europe. It's a one-stop shop for finding out about all the different co-working spaces you can imagine in Europe, and also connecting companies to flexible workspace for their employees. In this video, we cover a lot of ground. We talk about the future of co-working spaces as an engine of culture, and we also look at that overlap between co-working and co-learning and what that could mean for learning ecosystems.
So Christoph, for people who don't know who you are, what you do, what's your like quick pitch?
Okay, I try to make it quick. So I'm a co-working activist. I started this 13 years ago, started the first co-working spaces in Germany, also in Europe, a couple of them. They are called Beta House. And I started, while working on that, I realized that then is slowly the need for a platform emerging. And like in any other business, I believe the future of flexible workspace lies in the hands of some sort of platform, like Airbnb, like Uber. And I had put it into my head to build this platform rather together with all the workspace operators than a top-down model. And that's my journey right now. So the platform is called One Coworking, and we try to provide on-demand access to companies, to individuals, to freelancers in all the workspaces in the world.
Awesome. And the way we were introduced was through OwnCo, which is enabling this co-ownership of platforms. So we're both sort of platform founders, and that's a big piece for unlocking value in the community and, you know, spreading the benefits. How's your vision for the platform sort of evolved over time, where like now we're thinking about co-ownership from the original inception from Beta House? So like what you've got, and how is that changing?
Yeah. You know, when you go back into the co-working history, I think most of the people who were in there early in the beginning didn't realize that it eventually will take over all sorts of real estate. It spread over to co-living, it spread over off to corporate offices. And I think it's really, it actually started to, it's shocking, because I already was impressed by the first years when all the freelancers said, oh, that's a great idea. Let's go into workspace and share it. So I have really stopped to making predictions, but my sense is that this kind of shared space or sharing economy approach with a lot of collaboration, giving humans, people what they need, getting them in touch, both for learning, but also for working, collaborating, is just taking over everything. It's like a fundamentally human desire, it seems, to have this sort of exchange and collaboration, but also, sorry, most importantly, the self-determination of doing what you want and not having to go to the office every day.
Yeah, it's interesting, this went away from virtual, and this is slightly as COVID, as a result of COVID. I'm curious, just on the COVID piece, what's changed before and after?
What have you noticed? I didn't get that. But that's definitely, so the one thing that I realized during COVID, it is really such a huge accelerant for people to take back control of their lives. For me, I'm not sure if that's a general realization, but I realized that the moment you let people work from home, they also realize, oh, I can take back this part of my life and make it a little bit more my own. And that has a lot of ripple down effects. I think they realize, oh, I can make a career change or I can move to another country. And it's funny that this was caused by this pandemic, which was rather awkward, but that it gives power. It seems it gives people power to make their own mind up.
Yeah, I'm curious, like, how many people really wanting to be back in the office and experience that connection? I know some companies are kind of, because you have the whole spectrum of people on your platform, right? You have like large corporates who just need distributed offices, and you also have maybe more like freelancers who just come in for the day. Is there a difference in their behavior of how they approach this new sort of location independent way?
So first of all, by now it's clear there's lots of data that circles in on 2 days of the 5 days a week at home or not in office. I mean, okay. So it's funny because across all types of companies, people really tend to stay at home on Mondays and on Fridays. Big surprise. I mean, they just basically extend their weekends in some way, but it poses a huge problem to the companies, or especially to real estate, because suddenly if you look at it just by the data, you see that 40% of office space is not needed anymore. And you can already see just the recent weeks for New York and for LA, there were the first news stories where skyscrapers, they stay empty and people give their leases back, and suddenly the project developers default. Another interesting point, I'm staying a little bit with the corporate part because that's where you've got a lot of data. So another interesting point is that you really see that still those locations who are in a very central spot that are easy to reach, that they even get more expensive because everybody now tries to have, if you have a location, no matter if you're a company, an organization, you want to get the people into your space, your office, you really 5 minutes make a big difference in terms of commuting times. So let's, you know, imagine Grand Central, everything is now on top of Grand Central, New York, so you can get there fast, but everything far away really is not that attractive anymore. And for freelance, you know, the world also has changed now because freelancers and remote employees, whereas there's a little bit, the spectrum gets really, how you call it? So there's not such a big difference between a freelancer working remote for a company and an employee working remote for a company, because it's just very transitory. Companies start to hire freelancers more. They can now stay in their lifestyle. You know, they can keep working remote, but they also can work for like a really proper company. And so this whole world has gotten a little bit more mixed up. I think the times, my last statement for that matter, they have really become more attractive for the employee, but also for the freelancers, because it's more accepted that you don't work anybody's customers or boss's office anymore. So definitely a win. What I don't know, you know, there's people say, okay, no, financial crisis coming. Elon Musk is getting everybody back to the office. It seems kind of right that when there's more pressure and the CEOs can demand more from the employees, that this flips back a little bit. But I think the long-term direction is really clear. I just wonder, you must know maybe a lot about universities and how much space they, or maybe schools. I don't know. Is there anything that you can say about this actually in terms of from the education industry?
Yeah, absolutely. I was going to start diving into that. So the thing that I noticed with co-working and co-learning, co-living even, a lot of that kind of movement happened when people started taking over these old industrial buildings, right? So you look into the most co-working spaces or co-living spaces as well, there it's always underused space, you know, because of the changing times and the ways we do things. I think something very similar is happening for learning and education. During the pandemic, universities were sort of buying sections of WeWork and saying, oh, for our learners who are stuck in this country, we'll, you know, hire this office space, you can still do your learning. And that, so that was one behavior that's happening there with the universities. But more broadly, I think this is just a repeating pattern in history. It's going to be something that education is starting to push into, to say, okay, how do we use this underutilized space? And you mentioned all these office blocks going underused. That's exactly what we're seeing with opening this learning center in Bristol. It's a Marks and Spencer's, which is a department store. It had all four floors of this huge central publicly owned building in the central of Bristol. And they don't want to give the lease to a private company or sell it. They have like 50 years on it or something crazy like this, but they're quite happy to give it to a charity or a social good project that can offset some of that cost. So I think that's something that's going to be happening a lot, is seeing new entrants come into this space, maybe alongside co-working operators, and making this co-learning model. And I'm curious, like, do you see any demand for co-learning? There's obviously daycares where if you're like a remote worker, you can leave your children at a daycare and then come. Or is there maybe more demand for people having them right next to each other? Or that's for the younger age groups, but then for the university students, do they want to be in more of these third spaces and get exposed to the realities of the workforce that are in the co-working space? You see,
I have a couple of thoughts there. Number one, there's definitely more and more virtual universities that do not have a campus at all. Like when you have a campus now and built a campus basically. But so they have the need, the students have the need to gather somewhere sometimes, either for socializing or even for learning. And it's really still in its infancy, because there's not many big ones, and the older established players, they already have their own campuses. But I can definitely see how this becomes a use case for co-working spaces, because we have all the infrastructure is affordable, and it gives the universities, the virtual ones, another kind of benefit for their students. And what you mentioned regarding getting in touch with interesting businesses, also a little bit do an orientation, what you want to do later in life when you grow up or something like that for younger kids. That I think definitely is another benefit. If you're studying business in a virtual university and then you stay in a co-working space that's entrepreneurial, that's the best combination of practice and theory. You probably get your first job immediately. The other aspect though is that now with the advent of more remote and hybrid working, also families tend to develop the desire to live in Spain for half a year. And then kids, the question is, where do those kids go? So workspaces and also platforms and networks here and there try to find solutions for them. For preschool, it's relatively easy, I think, because they just provide daycare or maybe work together with a local daycare provider. For schools, there are already the first signs that there's a wish to kind of coordinate the learning plans, education plans a little bit, and form communities that can possibly, that have a synchronized education plan. But you can still go from Lisbon to Berlin, you know, so that I think I'm really curious. I want to try this myself. My kids are young, still they're 1 and 4 years old, but I hope until they go to school, there's some sort of solution for that. And also, I think most importantly, kind of a built-in culture at school that basically promotes this type of behavior and doesn't kind of, I feel in the old school system, it's kind of penalized. If you, there's this new kid, you know, it's not like normal. There's like people from all around the world. There's a couple of new entrants. This season where they're coming from, super interesting. Let's make this part of the whole education plan. It's more like you're the loser if you come from and the locals rule the schoolyard. So I think that's a lot of things that we will see the next years. And I wonder what happens if in your case, if the office buildings, I have no clue if we ever need much office again that we have now in our cities. And if what part of this will be taken over by workspaces, schools. I feel there's just, if you just, you know, we just need half of it right now. I think there should be build housing. Well, that's probably what's most needed, right?
Yeah, the housing question comes up a lot. There's obviously kind of, it's tricky to transition commercial space to housing. It's totally possible. There are other things. It does seem easier to do it as co-working and for education. So I think it's in the, you know, an idea that time has come, and we'll see it more in the next couple of years. The thing that we're noticing is sort of tensions around the finite resource of space and funding. Like, who funds the learning that's happening in these spaces, and how much space can we actually give from, let's say it's happening at a co-working space, right? If you're playing in a greenfield and you buy up the commercial space, you can kind of do whatever you want with it. But let's go with the case that we're going to use co-working spaces, probably those ones in your network. And you kind of want to maximize desk space as an operator. So from the operator perspective, how flexible do you think these operators are in saying, oh yeah, no, we can make all this space for university students to pass through here and have this rich, you know, multinational interdisciplinary curriculum? Are they kind of open to that? Are they just trying to squeeze in desk space? And then maybe we can get into the funding part second, but yeah. You see there, because you do need to maximize that space as an operator.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, from my own practical experience in Beta House, we had a couple of university groups that would spend their summer in Berlin, a group of students of architecture, but also different ones, coding schools, and not yet kids under 18 that are going into primary, secondary school, that they don't know what they need. I don't have that much experience. But the higher education groups usually have very similar needs to those that companies have, because they need to meet, they need to have presentations once in a while. In a bigger setting, this is like an event space. And then there's some sort of concentrated work and social stuff. You know, you can go down to the bar, the roof terrace. Every Thursday, there's a barbecue. So it's kind of compatible with what they anyways want to do. So they just can join in. And in that case, usually those groups also have a budget that they can use, and everything that a startup can afford. We are Beta House as a startup co-working space, usually can be afforded also by university or by a program like that. So I think if there's not such a big difference in their needs. When I think about kids, the other experience I have is with it's daycare, because there's quite a growing group of co-working spaces that also offers daycare. Those are very different from the regular co-working space. They're usually way, way smaller to keep it more intimate and also more, I think it wouldn't be fair to a group of children to be in the middle of a like 1,000 people, high intensity office environment. Right? So those daycare co-working centers are usually small and they're somewhere in a nice place. And they are very selective in who joins, or at least they have a conversation with everybody who wants to join so they can curate it a little bit more. But then it becomes incredibly powerful for single moms or dads, especially those that are maybe new in town and do not yet have access to the state's offerings. And companies, their companies, their employers, they like it because they have a simple way to just pay for workspace, but it includes daycare and it's just one thing to greenlight, you know? And so these are the experiences I can talk about.
I think it's much more compatible with the higher ed groups. They're much more like freelancers or small teams. Daycare seems like an easy bundle, right? You just sort of plug that in. I guess, the real trick is going to be the high school ages. And I think that's kind of where we like to poke at City as a School, is that new infrastructure for high school. Because to come back to the funding piece, one thing we're trying to enable is pathways into industry that are funded by the employers. Basically, you can imagine, take the game industry. A couple of them are going to be spending money on recruiting, but maybe getting a couple like 18 and 19 year olds who are super talented just coming out of high school is also in their interest, either intern level or entry level. And one place they can be doing that learning, you know, it's homeschoolers for now, but this might be everybody's sort of place to learn in the future, could be at these co-learning centers that are sort of either adjacent to or on the floor below a co-working space. At least in Bristol, This is kind of what we're seeing. I think someone coined this the sandwich model, like sandwich. There's three layers, although the lasagna model, that sort of works. There's three layers of offices. So there's the top three floors are taken as co-working. The second floor is all for young people and students from university to high school. And then the bottom floor is like sort of cafe, third space type thing. And I think that model works if you put like a department store or multi-floors. And I think probably that's our best bet right now, is to say, we can't take over the whole second half of your second floor co-working space. But if we've got this stack, there is an ecosystem that young people are learning in. The employers are paying for the learning. They're surrounded by these people who are in the industry and they can find mentors. That's what I'm kind of hopeful for as a model.
Yeah. I totally can see that as a successful model, especially because we see co-working centers or buildings. Now I said it, people start to see it more as like a whole building that has some permanent levels up top with corporates, but it's in its entirety is the represents the co-working of flex office. You could also call it flex office, right? And so I think it's we start to get to the point where the people in the building will have a lot more contact with each other and also be able to exchange. And this is, you know, we're now developing or working with a developer on a new project where there's a 20,000 square meter. What's that? That's a lot more square foot. I cannot do the math right now, but it's a massive building. And it is exactly how you said. The basement or not the ground floor is, you can go for lunch there. There's a couple of shops. But then there's this first and second floor, which is the heart, the kind of the interaction area, which includes event spaces, but also a coffee shop, another canteen. But also whenever anybody wants to do meetings or has some like open space needs where needs a couple of desk working groups, it all comes together there. But then there's a university up top. There's this, I don't know if this, they were talking about a private school there as well. And so once the whole building is designed like this, you have what you were talking about naturally, you know, and then I really think that's one of the problems of the past, that when I went to school, I was entirely siloed away and I had no clue. Maybe there were some advantages about it that I'm not aware of. Maybe more focused, more time, you know, a little bit also protected. But I was just, my mind was blown when I moved to Berlin and realized what type of jobs exist. And not only what was in the books or what you kind of get taught by your parents. And I think if that would happen much earlier, just a real life awareness instead of, you know, I'm preaching to the choir, of course, I guess, right? But this, it would have brought me forward years, you know, I was like poking around, how much did I study? And just like 3-4 years later, I had talked to enough people that told me about their lives that I could know what my career would be.
Yeah, that's absolutely what we're going for at City of School. And it's the thing we consistently hear with parents of homeschoolers, but also, you know, high schoolers, 17 and 18, and just going, I keep seeing stuff on YouTube. Like I see someone's got this cool job, but I don't know why the school doesn't connect to this. And there's the relevance of what's happening in school is now, you know, deeply questioned with, you know, the age of the internet. And I think, yeah, exposing them to that, to the breadth of different career paths, the seeing people actually like, you know, what does it mean to be a product designer? Like, what are these people doing when they're on their screen the whole time? Look over their shoulder.
Where can I become this? You know, yeah. I got a question for you when you mentioned YouTube, because I'm also super impressed by what kids can teach themselves from dance, you know, and really to a level that looks really professional in the end. And I wonder to what extent does this replace the need for a school and what you still, what is the things that you still have to provide in a learning environment? Because you could say, you can do everything at home. I mean, I just put my kid in front of the YouTube all day and then it's like super, super smart and can do everything.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, there's such a varying degree between a sort of wide range of people who really, on one hand, self-determined, like they have agency, they make choices, they go, I've got to work on that thing next and I know how to do it. And those people who are more dependent and they just require instruction and they require more mentorship, more friends, more materials. My belief is that we've just designed it that way, that we have more dependent and low agency young people. And you can see like a child is just a super fast learning technology. They have this inbuilt capacity to do this. We all do. It's a human function. And at some point this kind of gets eroded. So what you see with like YouTube and the drive towards that is it's definitely wonder, curiosity, inspiration. These things are driving. It's like, oh, you know, I want to like dance and I get really good at dance. So like, I want to also have a YouTube channel and like, I want to show off that I can do all these cool things. There's this intrinsic drive. And I think schools can adapt to this. Some do. There are some great schools that really promote agency at their core. And really, I think it's going to come from transitioning away like at scale. You get these weird kids who can kind of do it at home school and they do just learn at home. They're totally fine with that. Getting the bulk of young people towards this, I think comes in thinking about the environment as the teacher or the system as the curriculum. This is called like the third teacher in architecture. sometimes that the space informs like how you learn. We don't have enough like teachers at scale to get the billions of young people to kind of be self-determined. But as they interact with tools, as they interact with other high agency people in co-working spaces, that's my hope, is that they kind of build the self-determinism that they can say, you know, I can set a goal. I don't know how to get there yet, but I can figure it out, versus I'm just waiting for the content to come to me. I think that's just a design challenge that we have as education designers. And that's something which these spaces kind of unlock when they see inspiration, they see models of working stuff around them, and they have these tools like, I don't know, Notion or whatever it is that they use. They think differently because of that.
So what do you think is the most important space inside a learning center, co-working space for that matter? Is there anything that sticks out that is like, you know, in the office world, it's like the water cooler or the photocopier? What is it in the school context?
Yeah, I think having these spaces to, where do they come from? Young people's time is so scheduled right now. Like high schoolers do school, like 9 to 3, 9 to 4. And then they have after school, 9 to 5. And I think they might play football or something. Young people just don't, they spend too long in school. They spend too long doing scheduled things. So, you know, people like to talk about like the benefits of play. I think it's kind of, it's more than play. It's just the ability, given enough space to think and feel into like what they want to do. And that might just be a cushion area in the co-working space where they can hang out and have their laptops open and talk to people. I really think people are transformed by people and also transformed by their tools and their environment, but it's enabling enough just free time to go and do that. You know, that can be like a booked out event space, but it could just be the water cooler again. I think it's very similar to like what happens in co-working anyway. But yeah, there isn't enough of that for young people. They're just so overscheduled, trying to drive towards some kind of goal somewhere and not given enough space just to go, like, what am I curious about? Like, what's interesting? Oh, can I speak to this person? Oh, that was wrong. I can change direction. It's like, no, you need to move at this pace.
This reminds me of a saying or a statement that is many times repeated in co-working. It's because everybody is so obsessed with the space, but actually what co-working means, co-working is an activity. You do.
Yeah.
And it happens to be also that sometimes you need a space to meet, but you could even be co-working without a co-working space. And I feel it reflects that the unintended, I mean, it is an intention then to let them develop themselves. But the first place when you think about school or work, you just think about what you have to do and scheduling, what the tasks. Yeah. But the actual powerful aspect is the unintentional things that happen when you meet different people. And it's something that I actually also as a professional in that area have to remind myself constantly, because as physical beings, we always revert to what should the color of the desk be? Or all these secondary things that are somehow necessary, but not the most important things. So what I like to see in the future is to actually remove this frame a little bit and to realize that, and that's what I strongly believe, that work where it's just some sort of cloud cover that you think you need to do for many reasons, for career reasons, for making money to survive, pay your rent, to actually find yourself and understand what you're doing and learn and become somebody. So I find it and really ironic that co-working spaces are so having the work in the name. It's the easiest thing to sell. People need office, but what people really want to do and what they come for is they want to develop and become somebody new, right?
Yeah, no, I love that. It's changing the frame from it being about the physical space to kind of like an activity that we're doing together. And perhaps this is also a good line of thinking for thinking about what co-learning means. You know, it's not a co-learning, just a co-learning space. It's something that we are doing together and we're all changing each other. And those chance interactions, which might change the course of your life or inspire you to go a different way. And I think that's really what kind of is a huge win for coworkers and maybe even co-learners of the future. Christoph, what's a message that you'd like to leave the audience with before we get into where they can find you?
Yeah. So I would really encourage everybody who works from home or now has the freedom to choose where to work in general to give it a try and pick a co-working space nearby. If you haven't done this ever, there's a lot of people who know about the concept, think of it as a kind of time based office, but it's much more than that. And try to find a local community-based co-working space and to realize what you might be missing. And if it's not for you, that's fine as well, as many people just like to work at home. But I feel it's rather that you don't know and maybe find something there than that you don't need it, if that makes sense. So yeah, and if you want to do that, and especially in continental Europe, we have many co-working spaces on our app, One Coworking. And if that's not, if you're not around here, live somewhere, it's just Google is a really good resource too to find your co-working space and go meet your local co-workers in the co-working space and learn.
Awesome. And how can people connect with you? Are there any links that people can find you at?
Sure. So our service, you find at onecoworking.com. Really easy. And I'm mostly active on LinkedIn. Put my name in, Christoph Fahle. And I'm super happy to help. If anybody has questions, just hit me up with a direct message. That makes my day. If I can talk to people and learn something and help a little bit. So yeah, feel free.
Lovely. Christoph, it's been a pleasure. Hopefully we can do this in a couple of years' time and the world will look very different. And we'll have more insights to share.